this presentation is about solving problems, at least getting started with solving problems. I don't know how many times students come in to see me for help, and the first thing they say is they don't even know where to start the problems. Hopefully, through this presentation, you'll be able to dig in and get started. When I look at a problem, the first thing I do as I read it is I try to find if there are any relationships defined in the problem. For instance, the relationship between inches and centimeters, miles and hours. And I also look for data that has just simple units. Notice that they just say minutes. They're not relating the minutes to anything or the centimeters. So those tend to be where we start working problems. So I'm going to go through a bunch of problems here, and we'll take a look at picking out the data that's important. Okay. So here's a problem that's asking you to find a person's weight, and for some reason we know their weight in stones. So the first thing I pick out of this is that the person weighs 8.65 stones, whatever the heck that is. And I find another relationship stated in there that one stone is equal to 14 pounds. So those are the first two things that I'm going to write down before I get started. So one stone is equal to 14 pounds. Another way of writing that, if you remember from the conversion factor presentation, that we can write these as ratios as long as they are stated as being equal to one another. So one stone is equal to 14 pounds, or 14 pounds is equal to one stone. Eventually, when we get to putting everything together in what we call a factor label problem, we can choose between these depending upon how the data needs to be arranged. So we're going to do this by canceling units. So these are the two things I write down for this problem. Let's look at another problem. Here's a longer problem where somehow we're concerned with the equivalent amount of caffeine between chocolate and coffee. So I've got a 1 ounce piece of chocolate that contains 15 grams. So there is an equality stated there. So 1 ounce is equal to 15 milligrams of caffeine. One cup here appears to be defined as 6 ounces. That 6 ounce coffee is 105 milligrams of caffeine. So I can say that 6 ounces is equal to 105 milligrams. I could even state that one cup is equal to 6 ounces. So we're concerned with the question here. So how much chocolate would you have to consume to get as much caffeine as you would from 2 cups of coffee? So 2 cups. So there's no relationship between the 2 cups and anything else. So that's my simple unit. That's probably where I'm going to start my problem. So let's write these things down. So I've got 1 ounce is equal to 15 milligrams of coffee. I can write these possible relationships that I can use. The same for the 6 ounces of coffee contains a milligram or 105 milligrams of caffeine. So let's see, chloroform here, another problem. We know things about it. It's 14.83 grams per milliliter. The slash there is essentially stacking the units for us. Telling us that 1.483 grams is equal to exactly 1 milliliter. And we want to know how many milliliters are needed for 9.37 grams. So I'm going to write down the relationship, and I'm also going to write down the simple gram quantity that we're likely to be starting with in this. Okay, sometimes you'll find problems where one problem refers to another problem. So in this, here were a series of problems, one relating to finding out the mass of the Hope Diamond in ounces, and another relating to the Hope Diamond and finding out what the volume is and how many carbon atoms it actually contains. So let's kind of talk through this. The first one tells us that 1 carat is exactly 200 milligrams, so that's a conversion factor, and we can write that as a stacked set of units. The Hope Diamond itself is 44 carats. It doesn't have an equality, so that is likely to be my starting point. There are some hidden relationships in this. They tell you some things, but they expect you to know others. For instance, the relationship between milligrams and grams. And ultimately, we have to get to ounces, so we probably need to relate grams and ounces. I quickly Googled this relationship because I don't keep this one at the top of my head. It is 28.35 grams is equal to 1 ounce, and we can again write that as a series of stacked relationships so that we can use it depending upon what we need to use. Okay, the other one tells us that 0.1 grams of carbon or of this diamond contain 5.014 times 10 to the 21 carbon atoms. Again, a stacked relationship, and we have a relationship again between density with density that relates grams and centimeters cubed. Okay, here's a problem with an irregularly shaped chunk of silicon. We know the mass. Somebody's placed this on a balance and massed it. And they seem to have dropped it into a graduated cylinder and noted the initial and final volumes. So they have a means of calculating the volume. Now this is a problem where, since we know the formula for density as being mass over volume, I can measure the mass, I can measure the volume, so it sometimes is something where we can just use a formula. But I'm going to tabulate these things. So I've got density as mass over volume, I know the mass, and I can calculate the volume. So all I have to do is plug into that formula and I'll be done. But we'll do that in another video. Okay, here's a really long problem here. All of the vital information is contained in really the last sentence here. So the dosage of this stuff is 20 micrograms per kilogram of body weight. And I need to know how many milligrams a 160-pound patient should receive. So the 160-pound mass or weight here is what we need to start with. And the 20 micrograms per kilogram is a relationship that's stated in the problem. There's all kinds of unstated problems, like how many micrograms are in a gram, how many grams are in a kilogram, how many, how do pounds and kilograms relate to one another? So we're going to have to either remember these, or we can look someplace like the back of her book, the inside cover of her back of her book, or one of those last pages of the book have a great table of the relationships that we might need. So here it is all tabulated, that 20 micrograms per 1 kilogram of weight, or I can flip it. The 160-pound patient is the one where I'm going to start with. The hidden relationships, like I said, are micrograms to grams and kilograms to pound. So it's 1 times 10 to the 6, and I forgot to write that, I put that in superscript there, so that 1 times 10, that 6 should be superscripted in this. So that tells me that there are 1,000,000 micrograms per gram. And see, we also need milligrams. That's not stated here, but I've got, I should probably have included that 1,000 milligrams are in a gram, so I'm going to need to use both relationships. Sorry, I didn't get that one put in here. I got so excited about writing all this down. And that we also have 2.2 pounds is equal to 1 kilogram. Here's one that has kind of two layers to it. We've got a set of equalities. 1 gram of sodium reacts with 1.54 grams of chlorine to produce 2.54 grams of sodium chloride, and also produce 17.9 kilojoules of heat. So we can actually, since they're all those quantities are equal to one another, we could write a series of equalities. So I'm just going to write these all as an equality because they can all be related. So for instance, I could say 1 gram of sodium is equal to 17.9 kilojoules, or 1.54 grams of chlorine is equal to 2.54 grams of sodium chloride. Since they're all equal to one another, I can come up with a series, and then, I don't know, there's like about 16 possible relationships that can be got out of that. And then our starting point looks like it would be the 171 kilocalories. We've got all kinds of hidden relationships. We've got kilocalories, so we probably need to relate kilocalories to calories. We've got kilojoules, which is another unit of energy. So kilojoules and joules need to be related. And there's probably a relationship between joules and calories, two different means of measuring energy. So I kind of wrote these down here. That first one, that all of those things are equal to one another, so I could develop a whole bunch of stacked relationships between those. Our starting point is likely to be the 171 kilocalories. And we've got all kinds of hidden relationships here, like I said, between kilojoules and joules, kcals and cals, and joules and calories. So I kind of tabulated those. I didn't write those out as stacked relationships. I think that's the last of the problems that I've kind of pulled out as examples for finding starting points and initial relationships. The next presentation will be about actually working these problems. So stay tuned for that.